We began a study in Hosea chapter 11 a few weeks ago, and the topic of the study is God's prodigal, and that is what's the title of the sheet that you have. This section of the Word of God from chapter 11 through 14 in Hosea is somewhat unique in that there are many sections within this set of chapters that has the voice of God explaining his love to a prodigal son. Okay? So it's the voice of God explaining his own heart about a situation that he is not pleased with, but at the same time, his heart is demonstrated in relationship to a child that is not walking with him. And there are very few places in the Word of God where you have the heart of God speaking about his own love. And he talks about what he sees in the future. He talks about the plans of all the things he has for us. He does give us his love in many different places, but often that description of love comes from like Paul or John, who are actually describing that love, like the love chapter of 1 Corinthians 13. That's not the voice of God directly. Okay, so in this particular case, we're actually having the voice of God speaking to us about how he feels about this son, but his love just bursts through. And you can go through it and you can and just start listing all sorts of actions and ideas and thoughts about his heart. And they're varied, they're different, and in each one of the different sections that this breaks forth. We looked at the first one is 1 through 4 in chapter 11. And we have a long concept. There are many, many ideas about the love of God. So that's where it starts. It starts with the idea that you and I are his sons and his daughters, who he's called out of Egypt. He's called us out of things that have broken us and sins that have entangled us and a slavery that is a part of our own making. Okay? And so that's what you see him describe. And it begins with the very concept, I've loved him. Okay, I loved him and I called him out. And as a father dealt with a son, okay, trying to help him walk, trying to teach him where to go. And when he fell, the falling, I know that he was going to fall. That's a part of the walking process. They're, you know, if you take a child, you know they're going to fall, but they got to walk. Okay, but when they fall, I pick them up and I hold them in my arms and I heal them. Then I sit them back down and let them start walking again. Okay, and so that's what you're seeing in that first section. He bends down. Okay, and he removes the yoke that basically controls us. Okay, and he heals us, and he causes us to move towards a purpose. Okay, so that's what we got out of that first section. Then it goes on to describe, and this is typical of this, we have a description of God's love, and then he moves to the prodigal part, where the sins are described, and then he moves back to the love. And then he moves to the sins, and then back to the love. And so this is the way you see this develop in terms of what's going on. So we have this sin section that's basically 4 through 7 in chapter 11. And then beginning in verse 8 down to verse 11, there is another breaking out of the heart of God. How can I let you go? Even though you're this way, how can I do this? 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 The compassions in my soul drive me deep and cause my heart to just flip right over. Even if you're in the midst of the sin and will not turn to me, I cannot let you go. I will not let you go. And so it's a very assuring, deep understanding that once you're a child of God, you are not going to be let go, even though you do not do this right and do this well. Okay, so it's extremely reassuring. And then at the very end there, he says in verse 10, I can see the future. You cannot. I've showed you the future in the Word of God, but you don't see the future like I see it. Okay, there will be a time where you really, truly will walk with me. And my voice will call to you. Instead of you turning around and not listening, you'll turn and face me with trembling hearts. And I will roar like a lion and bring you home. And I will settle you with me. Okay, and so that's how that section ends. And then he moves back to the sins. Okay, and we looked at the sins last week, beginning in verse 12 of chapter 11. And we didn't get very far. We got to one phrase of one verse. Okay. Ephraim surrounds me with lies, and the house of Israel with deceit. And that's what we looked at. What are the lies and the deceits that you and I, as being children of God, might surround God with? What does he mean by that? And so we spent a great deal of time kind of looking that. We went to John 8, where Jesus talks about people who are given to lies, okay, and how we, in a lot of ways, do not understand the nature of God, and we only want to understand the nature of God according to our own desires and wants. Okay. And often what you find is that you change God into something that you want of God. And that becomes a lie. Okay, and you become hypocritical. In other words, you form this idea that is not God's idea at all. And that, of course, was what the Pharisees were. And what he was talking about in chapter 8, he was talking directly to them. You are religious people, you say, but your concept of me is a lie. And when I tell you the truth, you don't listen to the truth because you want the lie so much. And you're following the wrong father. You're following the father of lies. Okay. And so that's essentially what we were talking about there. Now, on your sheet there is number 2, which is the second part of that verse that has to do with the sin that God is pointing out. So we have listed there under Roman numeral 1, 4 different sins that God changes from his depiction of love in chapter 11. And he begins to move to verse 12, and he begins to unfold these sins that they have. And then the last part that we have there, number 2, Roman numeral 2, is the punishment that he's going to mete out because of these sins, a discipline that he's going to incur because of these sins. But then in number 3 and 4, Roman number 3 and 4, there's a shift of tone again that moves back towards love. Okay, so it's, again, same pattern, system of sins, and then God's shifting back to a tone of love. And that ends with verse 6. Okay, so let me read these verses to you, and then we'll go over them. I'm not going to read them. I won't have enough time to get over them. Okay, so you just follow along as we go through them. Okay, so look at verse 12. In chapter 11, okay? You surround me with lies and deceits. You are unruly against God, against the Holy One who is faithful. Now, what is this type of sin? We looked at that on what are the lies, but this is a different type of sin, okay? He says you're unruly against God. Okay, and he uses the word against twice. Okay, you're against the Holy One who is faithful. All right, so what sin is this unruliness before God? Rebellion. What?
Rebellion.
Okay, and how would you describe a rebellion?
Rebellion is I choose my own way.
Okay.
I've been in rebellion and it's very costly.
Okay.
You can be deceived. You can deceive yourself if you're doing that. And it's going the wrong way.
Okay.
Thinking you know better than God.
Okay.
Because
What was that now?
I said, repeat what he said.
Okay, he said it's rebellion.
Okay.
okay, and you're choosing your own way. What other ways would you talk about an unruly child? I mean, don't we all have unruly children?
Weren't we unruly children?
What?
Weren't
we unruly children? That's right. That's right. What would you mean by an unruly child? Yeah, that's certainly one way, that's for sure. Okay? If you've ever, you know, sit there and look at a child and say, why don't you go this way? And that child just gives you that stare, you know, that basically says, that isn't going to happen. you know? And all of a sudden you would go, unruly, just take the word unruly. What does it mean? Well, it's against, but the word, rule. I'm not going to follow the rules. Okay, that's an unruly child. It's a pretty easy, that's a rebellion. Right on the notes. These are the rules that set you towards life. These are the rules that set you towards fullness. These are the rules that set you to righteousness. These are the rules that give you peace. These are the rules that unfold what love is. And if you say any of these rules to almost anybody in a counseling session, you'll hear them say, I'm not going to do that. Inside their mind and in their heart, even if they don't say it out loud, though they will definitely, many of them will say it out loud, particularly in marriage counseling. Okay, you sit down and you say, this is the way you need to go. This is the things that will set you free. They will say, I'm not doing that. Okay, I am not doing that. In fact, you'll have them get up and leave. Okay, we're not talking about a child now. Okay, so these are the things that God has set forth that give us life, and we choose not to follow them.
Okay, against
they're against authority. That's exactly right. Authority, and that's what he said too. In other words, what it is that you are rebelling against is somebody telling you what to do. And when in reality, you think that you want to do it, you may even know that what you want to go this direction is not right, but you want to go this way because you're mad, you're angry, you're hurt, you're, you know, all sorts of kinds of things, okay, in terms of what's going on. Now, one of the problems that you will find when you study this, just like we looked at the lies, if I writ this to you, you would actually remove yourself from this particular position and you would not examine that or apply it to you. You look at this and you go, these are Israel and these people are far gone down the road. And that is true. The problem is that these sins plague us just as much as anybody that's far down the road. Okay, and if you don't acknowledge that, if you don't see this, then you yourself will find the position that you will have in the next verses, which is discipline. Okay, from a loving God. Okay. But that is something that we have to be. When I read this, I thought in my mind, I don't know if I'm really deceitful before God, but then I begin to examine that and begin to realize that I am deceitful. Okay, deceitful in that I even hide things from myself, okay, in terms of my deceit, much less just hide them from God, okay. But this one, when I read the word unruly, against God, against the Holy One, okay, this means the right one, the whole one. The one who is absolutely correct. Okay? And then the other word that was mentioned here is faithful. Okay? So it says, Judah is also unruly against God, even against the Holy One who is faithful. Now, what you see here is the unruliness is against the holiness. The unruliness is against the faith, the sureness of God and what he is. Okay. The thing is that most often why you're unruly has to do with a direction that God has set for your life, and you don't like it. So you're unruly. It is a direction that he has set, okay, to either wake you up, cause you to examine your life, or deal with something that's a part of what you need to look at, or he's allowing your faith to grow, and he's allowing your love to be understood better. And it's a trying, difficult, hard time. Okay? Now, everybody in this room knows exactly what that feels like. Because look at Bruce. I mean, how many would like to drive down there going 40 miles an hour and have two blowouts? You know? I mean, that's not a nice trip. Okay? But in that trip, because Bruce loves the Lord, within those circumstances, a man has to learn what the holiness of God is trying to bring to him and cause within the circumstances to see things that God is trying to give to him, because he wouldn't allow it to happen. It wouldn't pass through his hands. He wouldn't allow it to happen. It's a small thing. Okay, it's a small thing. Okay, but you got the small things and the big things. And what we are is unruly against it. There isn't anybody in this room that doesn't become unruly when those kinds of circumstances put up their head. That's all there's to it. When you go through with your, I mean, here you are on this wonderful trip. Did you have to come home from the trip? The trip that you went on because of your daughter.
Did you have to come home?
I mean, because of the cancer.
No,
she had that already sensed.
We came home.
Yeah.
Susan and his son were there waiting.
Okay. What I'm trying to say is all of a sudden you've got a circumstance that comes into your life almost daily that disturbs you. Okay. And the first my first reaction is, oh, gee. You know? It isn't, oh, hallelujah. It's, oh, gee. In fact, that's probably the nicest way I would say it. And what we have really done is moved unto unruliness. And what? Against the holiness of God. Okay. In other words, his choice for you to be made fuller, to be made holy. More, okay, and it's a rejection of that idea, okay, and that's the problem. Now, the other thing that you have to see is when you look at this verse, is he is faithful, and you're not, because you're being unruly. But he's still faithful. He's holy, and he's faithful, and he won't back off. Because he's faithful. Okay. And what you're seeing there is that you can trust his love, you can trust his discipline, you can trust who he is, because he is holy. He has chosen the absolute best way to move through this circumstance. Now, I'm telling you the principles. I am not telling you that I do this well. I do not do this well. Okay, I am unruly. Okay, so all I'm trying to show you is that's the principle that's being set. Okay, and we have to get a hold of it because he has chosen the best to move through this. Okay, now it is working with all that is not good in a world that has gone wrong, but he has promised that all that is not good he will use to make better. He is faithful to cause that to happen. So when you end the whole process, you are unruly, you're against him, he is the holy one, he chooses all that is right, you're against that too. Okay. And then at the very end it says, but he's faithful. He won't give up. He won't change. He will remain true. And what he said about you and what he felt about you in verses 1 through 4, okay, and the other verses, how can I give you up? He is faithful. Yes. Did you have something?
Yeah, I was just thinking about the catalytic converter going out. I mean, God was taking care of him because what if he'd been driving 80 miles an hour?
Yeah.
You know,
right.
God is faithful.
That's right. Yes.
When it talks about rebellion, 1 Samuel 15:23, that rebellion is the sin of divination. So it goes back to
That's a very good point.
Rebellion in heaven.
Yeah.
And then you see that again with Eve.
That's right. It's very good.
So it's a very serious matter.
Yeah. It's a very serious matter.
What did you say?
Well, the first real rebellion was in the mind of Satan. And that's where it first started. And it's called what? The spirit of divination. And what that means is it's the spirit of Satan. Okay. And as she was saying, to you and I being unruly, you know, having a bad attitude about this whole situation, we got to see that it's a lot more serious than that. Okay. You're moving in a direction that is satanic. Okay. That is the exact way that Satan moved. And got himself in real trouble. So that's what she's pointing out.
Well, it's irreversible without the miracle of God.
That's exactly right.
That syndrome is just there.
That's exactly right. It's a part of it. All right. The next sin that is mentioned. This one is, and I'm sorry because of all the responsibilities I have and whatever, I like to track all these things down, and I do track a lot of them down, but I did not track this one down as far as I'd like to have tracked it. It says that Ephraim, the people of God, feed on the east wind. Okay, feed on the east wind. Now, if you want to take a little study and try to figure that one out, okay, as to what that really means, because what you would do is try to find out what the east wind is different than the north, south, and west wind. Okay, and more than likely it has to do with some kind of benefit that is not correct. It looks like it's a benefit, but it's not. Also, the word feed, okay, has the sense of continual. The attitude of these people were there's something wrong here in terms of the east wind. Something that is, they think it's beneficial, but in reality it's not. It's a trick, okay. And they're consistently drawn to it. They are going to something that they know they shouldn't go to. Okay, so it's a continual act. Okay, and that is really what is upsetting God. Okay.
Could that be kind of like the worldview?
It very well can be. And the other word, feed, also is that this is what really kind of confuses me, so that's why I would have to study this longer. It means shepherd. It means to feed, and it means to shepherd. What it's saying is the east wind, they shepherd it. They work with it. They move it in directions that probably their own desires in some kind of manner. Okay, and this is not something that they just play with. They do this constantly. Okay, so whatever that is, and I'm sorry again, I can't nail it for you as to what it is, but those are some of the patterns. And what you're seeing is God is looking at this attitude. Is this is something these people won't give up. Okay, they're shepherding it all the time. It's like they keep coming back to it. And God keeps saying, stop going this way. Okay.
The footnote refers us back to 8:7, and the footnote on that one says it's the wind of idolatry.
Okay. And again, those would be some of those kinds of ideas that you wouldn't want to carry out farther.
So
what?
So, and then Assyria was the wind that came in.
Right. But I would like to know why the east wind. Okay. What's the significance of calling it the east wind?
Is that because Assyria is east?
Well, I don't know. That's what I said. I'd have to find that out. Didn't have a chance to go after that one. All right. The last sin that is mentioned is, and it looks like all of these things are kind of connected, so it's interesting. It's really exactly what he was pointing out at the very beginning. There's a sense inside of an unruly child who rebels against the ideas of God towards something that would be good for you, but you don't like it. The idea of going through the circumstance that Bruce is going through, you would never go, I like that. Okay? And God would just basically say to you, yeah, but it's good for you. You know, take this medicine because it'll heal you. Okay? That's right. And so the unruly child just spits it right back at you, you know, in terms of that. So the whole idea is, this one is they make a covenant with Assyria, which is an enemy. But behind the scenes, they're carrying oil down to Egypt to basically, it's kind of like, we'll work with you, but we'll also work with you. And we're going to play the middle against the, you know, both ends. And so what this is a device within your own mind to create safety for yourself. It's a device within your own mind to create safety for your own self. But it's not playing with God at all in the formula. In other words, everything that you're doing, God is not a part of what you're doing. What you're doing is seeking safety. Now, we've already talked about this many, many times. And when we look through the book of Proverbs, one of the things that you saw within the book of Proverbs is this deep desire for safety, okay? And for our age group, safety means an awful lot of different things, you know, health, wealth, okay, happiness, okay? All of those things, you know, are the American dream, and we're supposed to have it, okay? And yet we're trying to protect it with everything that we can possibly protect it with, okay? And according to the book of Proverbs, none of these things are wrong, but what you've done is you've gone to Assyria, you've gone to Egypt, you played your thing, you sat down all night long and got it all straight, you got it all invested, you got all this, you got your insurance card, you got all this kinds of stuff set up, and you haven't prayed one iota about God. Okay, you're essentially not including Him, okay, within the major issue of the safety, okay, and what God would want you to be. So we've talked about this issue many times, but that's exactly what this was talking about. And it looks as like the main issue is that essentially you do not want God to plan your life. You really, truly don't. You say you do, but you don't in terms of the actions of your life. All right. The judgment that you find is in verse 2. There are three things that are mentioned there. He says, I have a dispute with you, and I will punish you, and I will repay you. Okay, and I'm not going to spend time upon the judgment itself, but that's what it says. God, I think interesting about this is that God actually speaks to them and says, I'm in dispute with you about this. Okay, he has not moved to judgment yet. He's just calling you on the floor. Okay, it's like a child or a student who has done something wrong. They know it, but when you call them on the floor and you basically get them in the office and you say, I have a dispute with what you did. You're calling them on the floor. Okay, and of course, the first thing they want to do is tell you that there is no dispute. Okay, I'm not guilty. You know, I didn't do anything wrong. You know, don't bother me. I shouldn't be the one in here. It's him, you know, or it's that. It's not me. Okay, so it's a dispute between God and you as to what you're living, okay, and the way you're living. Okay. Now, I would say for Christian folks, people who walk into this church and sit down, this is something that we have to be really acknowledgeable about. Because the truth is, if I turn to Ernestine, who I happen to know is a woman who walks with God, and then I would say to Ernestine, there's some things there that I think need to be changed.
And I would quickly justify.
Yeah. and not only that, she would do a good job of it. Yeah. Okay. For you and me, our attitude is one of self-righteousness. Okay. And of course, that's the very thing that Jesus could not stand. When he puts his finger upon our life and it says, I have a dispute here. Okay, you go, what? You know, how could that be? That's really our attitude. And it is a self-righteousness that we will not even acknowledge that there is a problem when God himself puts his finger on it. Okay? Then the hammer comes. Okay? Then the judgment comes. Because there is no acknowledgement of the dispute. Now, if you look at all the prophets that he sent to these people, this was the major issue. The prophet is wrong, and we are right. And you're not even representing God. Okay? There was a total debate. There was no repentance. There was no sense of inside of them of forgiveness, the need of forgiveness. Okay, and they hated the prophet because he was bringing this issue up because they felt like they were just fine. Okay, as to what was going on. In fact, they considered themselves better than he, particularly the highest ranking members, okay, of the prophets themselves and the religious leaders, that they basically wanted to kill the prophet because his message indicted them and they considered themselves righteous. Okay, and so that was one of the biggest problems. Okay, it's an enormous danger. Okay, then what we get in is on that sheet there, number three and number four. This is when the tone shifts, and it's very subtle. It's hard to catch, okay, until you start going down through the next of the verses. What you're going to find is the number one things that seem to be bothering God as we go through this, the number one thing that he seems to bring over and over and over and over again. Okay? It has to do with what we looked at verse 7 in chapter 11. My people are bent on turning from me. Though they call them, and they are the prophets, even though I send a message to them directly about what's going on, they will not come to the one on high. Nor will they exalt him, make him king within their life. They're bent on not listening to me. Okay. That is the number one issue that I see as I work my way through these verses, okay, as to what's going on. And what you're going to find in this little passage here is he's going to bring example up, and the example is Jacob. He's going to use Jacob as a demonstration of his own response to a man who did not want really to listen to God, Jacob, who was self-sufficient within his own brain and in his own little mechanisms that he produced. He caused himself, he felt, to really truly make things work. He was brilliant in conniving and trickery. Okay? And everything he tried, he seemed to get away with. Okay. Now, when he tricked his brother Esau out of his blessing, when he tricked his brother Esau out of his birthright, almost lost his life over that one. Okay, but he didn't. And as he was wandering out, none of those acts that he produced were acts of God. They were acts within his own brain and his own corruption. However, God used those acts to fulfill his final will. Okay, even those sinful acts, he used those acts to actually bring Jacob to himself. Okay, but the acts were acts against God. And they were basically acts against God because they were his plans in getting what he wanted when he wanted it. Okay, and that's what we've just looked at, okay, in terms of these sins. And so God gives an example of Jacob, a man who is called by his very name, trickster, supplanter, okay, a man who works things for his own benefit and does a very good job of it. And because he does a good job of it, he feels inside of himself self-sufficient. He doesn't really need God. Okay? That's what he is. And that actually is his name, okay, as to what is going on. And so that's why God starts out. When he was young and when he was in his womb, he was the heel catcher. That's what his name means. It's the heel catcher. Okay, but the heel catcher really means supplanter. There goes my dream. I grab it and yank it back. Okay, I put my hand on it and I change it with the power of my own hand. I'm the heel catcher. Okay, and with the trickster within me and the power within my own mind, I can figure this out. And I can provide my safety. I can provide anything that I basically want to go after. I don't really need God. Okay, now that's what Jacob was. That was his initial being in terms of what he was. His name, I've got them there, and we don't have time to look at them. But the verses there that you have there, Genesis 25, 26, and 27, 36, is a description of his first birth, and he's called this. And then Esau, at the very end, turns around and looks, and he just got blinked out of everything. Okay, he just lost it all. His brother beat him. Okay, he was successful. He just got all the blessing. He turns to Isaac and he goes, "Isn't there anything left?" And Isaac says, "No, he got it all." Okay, and Esau, that his comment is, "What a supplanter! What a trickster!" That's exactly what the verse says.
His mother helped him.
That's right. That's right. His mother was right along with him.
He wasn't really self-sufficient.
Yeah, he did have to have his mom along. But as he went along, he beat Laban too.
Yeah.
Okay. As to what, and all of them were tricks. And it's amazing how God used these tricks to actually bless him. Okay. And as his life progresses, though, this verse really has a beautiful, in the womb, verse 3, he took his brother by the heel. In his maturity, that's the shift. So in the womb, he represents all these four sins that we just looked at. He's deceitful. He's a liar. Okay. He's an unruly child. He is against the Holy One. Okay. He acknowledges the Holy One. He sees that there is a God, but he just turns right around and goes on his own way. Okay, as to what's going on. And so that's what you see some of his attitude in terms of what these things have been talking about. So God has given an example here. Okay. And what he's really trying to do is open a door for them to turn around and come back. See, he just condemned them. Okay. And he said, "This is what you are. You're just like Jacob in his youth. In his maturity, he figured out that he was wrong. And he turned to me. Why don't you?" Now that's the message. Turn to me. Turn to me. Turn to me. Exalt me as God, who is really God. Submit your life and everything to me. Okay? That is the final message. And you find the final message in verse 6. "Therefore, be like your father Jacob, who became Israel." No longer Jacob. Okay? "Who came to me and had his name changed, and he really, truly understood Bethel." There are two examples given here. One is when Jacob wept. This is a word that's not used in the Genesis account when he wrestled with God. Okay. God tells you that when Jacob wrestled with me, he wept. Okay. It's not said in the Genesis account. Okay. He says in this account, he wept and he sought favor. When he was in the direst of needs, he had all this stuff, but he couldn't protect himself. He fell down in front of God, and he said, "God is camping next to me." If you actually read the count, that's the name that he actually named the place he stopped. Two camps. One's God, and one's his. And what he did was go out into the middle and meet God. He turned to him, and God came to him. Okay. And that's exactly what God said. When he came to me and he wept and he sought me, I came to him and I changed him. That's right. From Jacob to Israel. Okay. The one who perseveres for a blessing. Okay. Who one who will pray and pray and pray and pray until God responds. And God will come. He will come. That's exactly it. He says, why don't you turn around and pray to me and pray to me and pray to me? Turn, but you are bent on going away. See, that's the message. Weep. Come. Be with me. Okay? The next one he gives an example is Bethel. Bethel's the name that Jacob gave when he slept and saw the angels ascending and descending. And the word Bethel means the gateway to God. Okay? He woke up and he says, I'm going to name this place the gateway to God. I saw God ascending and descending. Okay? But then he went right on and carried on with the way he used to be. Okay? But when he met God and he wept and sought God, at the time of his greatest need, God came and touched him and changed him. Then a little bit farther down in his life, after God had already delivered him, God came to him again, and he listened to God. He told his family, get rid of everything that's wrong in this family. All your idols, all the things that are wrong. We're going to meet God. I'm going back to Bethel. That's exactly what he told him. Okay, in the passage that I've listed there for you. Okay. We're going back to Bethel, the house, the gate to God. And when he went there, God met him again and gave him this great huge blessing. Okay, he met him again. He spoke to him again. And he explains that. And he names the place again, Bethel. Okay. And so he sets up an altar and basically worships God there. And God comes to him and speaks to him, okay, in relationship to his life. And then that's what brings us to verse 6. Okay, therefore, if he did it and he's your father, you do it. Even though he was a man full of himself, okay, he did finally return to me. And you're not. Okay, and that's the example. Therefore, return to your God. Return to your God. The Lord is his name. Observe kindness and justice and wait for your God continually. Okay. So that's the final words that God gives to these people. Okay? So it's a very, very subtle but very beautiful description of how God goes out. And when you weep and when you seek, he responds. Even in the midst of the grossest of the worst sins. Okay? And the rebellion of a heart that is an unruly child. All right, well, we're finished. Sorry to hold you over a couple of minutes.